inside uncover of your knowledge. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Gracious God, have mercy on us. We confess that we have turned from you and given ourselves into the power of sin. We are truly sorry and humbly repent. In your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown, things we have done and things we have failed to do. Turn us again to you and uphold us by your Spirit, so that we may live and serve you in newness of life, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. God, who is rich in mercy, loved us, even when we were dead in sin, and made us alive together with Christ. By grace, you have been saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. Almighty God, strengthen you with power through the Holy Spirit, that Christ may live in your hearts through faith. Amen. We sing as our gathering hymn, number 310, Songs of Thankfulness and Praise. 310.
Thank you.
of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
We continue with the Kyrie, which you can find on page 138 in the front of your hymnal, and then our hymn of praise, This is the Feast of Victory, on 140.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord.
This morning, I was thinking about my grandfather. Anybody have grandparents? Yes, uh-huh. Am I think the grandparents are pretty cool? Yeah, good. I'm gonna guess as well. So here's some things I remember about my grandfather. When I was real little, the things that would have been at the top of my list of things that were cool about my grandfather, they had Legos at their house that I could play with. And my grandfather had a workshop full of tools that he would sometimes let me use and work with his supervision. And when I got to be a little bit older, maybe about Allison's age, he had a go-kart that he would let us ride around in the parking lot near where they lived, and that was awesome because I did not have a go-kart. And they had woods not far from their house, and I had no woods near where I lived growing up, and so it was fun. We would get to go on hikes and ride go-karts and make stuff with tools and play with Legos. There's lots of cool stuff at my grandpa's house. But as I look back, I don't think it's the stuff that I appreciate the most about him. As I think about it, he had all those cool things, but he didn't use them just for himself. Like when I would go and visit, I wouldn't find him sitting playing with the Legos already by himself. He would wait until I came. And he didn't build a go-kart so that he could ride around it. He built it so that his grandkids could ride around it. And he would never just go on walks in the woods by himself. He would go with me and with my brother, all those things, even the stuff that we would do in his workshop, he was taking time and energy out of other things he could be doing so that we could have that time together. So the more I look back, the more I think it wasn't just the cool stuff that he happened to have at his house, but that he chose to use that stuff to have time with me. That's pretty cool. I bet there's people in your life that are like that, whether it's parents or grandparents or aunts or uncles or even friends, that at first you might think, oh yeah, they're my friend because they have cool stuff. They have the latest video game, or they have a brand new iPhone, or they have a car and they can take me places, or whatever. But really what matters is how we realize how they use those things, how they use what they have to spend time with to show us that they care about us. In the long haul, when you look back, you're going to discover the people who matter most to you are not the people who have the coolest stuff, but the people who used whatever they had to show that they loved you, that you were important. And the reason I wanted to talk about this, the reason I've been thinking about this, is we're going to hear a story about Jesus today. And at first it might just seem like, wow, Jesus is a guy who can do cool things. Because Jesus, there's a party he's at, and he turns water into wine. That's amazing. That is a power I do not have. Does anybody here have the ability to turn water into wine? Any of you? No? Let's check the grown-ups. Anybody here have the ability to turn water into wine? I can barely turn water into lemonade when I have the powder pack and measured out in front of me, right? Jesus does this amazing thing, and that's great. But the point of the story isn't just, hey, Jesus can do cool stuff. But that when there was a couple who would have been embarrassed if everybody found out that they'd run out of wine, and they had the need, they asked Jesus for help, and Jesus was willing to help. Jesus chose to use what he had, the ability he had to show love to people who needed it. And that, to me, is amazing. That makes Jesus more than just a guy with cool stuff, because there's lots of people with cool stuff. There's lots of people with cool talents that I don't have in the world. None of them are worth giving our lives to, but Jesus uses his ability, his power, to bring life to you and to me and to everybody else around us. That's worth getting excited about. So I want to ask you this week to be thinking about how you face whatever is coming in front of you this week and to see that Jesus promises to go with you and to use his amazing, awesome power and ability to show you that he loves you. That's pretty awesome. Would you pray with me right where you are? Would you all join me in prayer right where you are too? Jesus, you are amazing. And if we were going to list off all the ways you are amazing, we'd be here all day. You have powers beyond ours. You command and own all the universe and all of its riches and power and substance. And yet you choose to use those things to help improve the lives of ordinary people like us, like you did at the wedding in Cana. Help us today to trust, not just that you can do cool stuff, but that you choose to use your time, your power, and your love to be with us and to show us love when we need it. Help us then to show that love to other people in times when they need it this week. We love you too, Jesus. Amen. Thank you all so much for coming up.
The first reading is from Isaiah 62, 1 through 5. A reading from Isaiah. For Zion's sake, I will not keep silent, and for Jerusalem's sake, I will not rest. Until her vindication shines out like dawn, and her salvation like a burning torch. The nations shall see your vindication, and all the kings your glory. and you shall be called by a new name that the mouth of the Lord will give. You shall be a crown of beauty in the hand of the Lord, and a royal diadem in the hand of your God. You shall no more be termed forsaken, and your land shall no more be termed desolate. But you shall be called, my daughter is in her, and your land married. For the Lord delights in you, and your land shall be married. For as a young man marries a young woman, so shall your builder marry you. And as the bridegroom rejoices over the bride, so shall your God rejoice over you. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The psalm of the day will be Psalm 36, verses 5 through 10. It's printed in the bulletin. I will read the regular type and the congregation will read the bold. Psalm 36. Your love, O Lord, reaches to the heavens and your faithfulness to the clouds.
Your righteousness is like the strong mountains, your justice like the great deep. You save humankind and animals, O Lord.
How priceless is your love, O God! All people take refuge under the shadow of your wings.
They feast upon the abundance of your house. You give them drink from the river of your delights.
For with you is the well of life, and in your light we see light.
Continue your loving kindness to those who know you, and your favor to those who are true of heart.
The word of the Lord. The second reading is from 1 Corinthians chapter 12, 1 through 11, a reading from 1 Corinthians. Now concerning spiritual gifts, brothers and sisters, I do not want you to be uninformed. You know that when you were pagans, you were enticed and led astray to idols that could not speak. Therefore, I want you to understand that no one speaking by the Spirit of God ever says, "Let Jesus be cursed," and no one can say, "Jesus is Lord," except by the Holy Spirit. Now there are varieties of gifts, but the same Spirit. And there are varieties of services, but the same Lord. And there are varieties of activities, but it is the same God who activates all of them in everyone. To each is given the manifestation of the Spirit for the common good. To one is given through the Spirit the utterance of wisdom, and to another the utterance of knowledge according to the same Spirit. To another faith by the same Spirit, to another gifts of healing by the one Spirit, to another the working of miracles, to another prophecy, to another the discernment of spirits, to another various kinds of tongues, to another the interpretation of tongues. All these are activated by one and the same Spirit, who allots to each one individually, just as the Spirit chooses. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
When the wine gave out, the mother of Jesus said to him, "I have no wine." And Jesus said to her, "Woman, what concern is that to you and to me? My hour has not yet come." His mother said to the servants, "Do whatever he tells you." Now standing there were 6 stone water jars for the Jewish rites of purification, each holding 20 or 30 gallons. Jesus said to them, "Fill the jars with water." And they filled them up to the brim. He said to them, "Now draw some out and take it to the chief steward." So they took it. When the steward tasted the water that had become wine and did not know where it had come from, though the servants who had drawn the water knew, the steward called the bridegroom and said to him, "Everyone serves the good wine first and then the inferior wine after the guests have become drunk. But you have kept the good wine until now." Jesus did this, the first of his signs, in Cana of Galilee and revealed his glory. And his disciples believed in him. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you,
Praise to you, O Christ.
The congregation may be seated. The stories say that Jesus was a worker of wonders. But that's not primarily why I love him. They say Jesus could perform miracles. But to me, that's not the most compelling, conclusive evidence that Jesus is the very Son of God, God with us. The stories all say Jesus had this amazing, uncanny, unearthly, divine power over the physical substance of the whole universe, from multiplying little loaves of bread and fish to feed a crowd, to healing people's eyesight or ears, to even turning water into wine. Those are all amazing things, and as we have clearly discussed with the children, powers that I do not have, and none of us in the rest of the room do either. But none of those are what I find utterly compelling about why I would give my life to this Jesus. To me, what makes Jesus worth orienting our whole lives around, what makes Jesus worth offering our deepest selves to and being shaped by, isn't what powerful things he could do, but his willingness to do them in ordinary circumstances for ordinary people, even when there's a list of reasons why he should. It's Jesus' willingness to do amazing things in the ordinary, even when his plan said otherwise, that says this Jesus is somebody worth offering our whole selves back to and discovering what Jesus will make out of us. You know how the story begins, right? Jesus and his mom have been invited. It seems like Jesus is Mary's plus one to the wedding. He's going to this wedding, and all Jesus' disciples are there, even though this is the very beginning of Jesus' public ministry. He's not done anything amazing yet when we are first introduced to him here in this story. Maybe he's barely come to be known as a wandering itinerant rabbi, but certainly doesn't have the prestige or the reputation for doing miracles yet. But he's invited to this wedding. There's something cool about that that we often skip over, that Jesus is the kind of person that people wanted to invite to their party. Sometimes I think we imagine Jesus being so dour or serious or only focused on quote-unquote spiritual things, we forget Jesus was the kind of person that when people are thinking of their wedding list of who should we invite, who would make a good celebration, oh, yeah, we should invite Jesus. Yeah, Jesus and his mom, they should both come. They have a way of bringing life to the parties they are at. And who knows, is this a family friend, somebody that Jesus had grown up with or gone to high school with, somebody that Jesus had known from way back, or a second cousin or something like that? Who knows, but Jesus isn't there as the official master of ceremonies. Jesus is there as guest because somebody thought of Jesus as a friend. That's amazing. We who are so quick to use official religious language, Jesus is Lord and God, God, light, true God from true God. All these things are true. Worker of wonders, doer of miracles, raiser of the dead, yes. Jesus was somebody's friend, too, and was willing to do the kinds of things that friends do, show up and celebrate with people. And then, when the wine gives out, Jesus' mom turns and says, what are we going to do about this? And you know how the story is, that the miracle almost happens while everybody's looking the other way, right? Jesus doesn't announce what he's going to do, he doesn't tell everybody the plan, he just tells the waitstaff, the caterers, hey, see those big stone jars they use for the Jewish rites of purification? Would you fill those up with water and draw out some of the water and give it to the MC, the DJ at the wedding reception, that sort of thing? And they do it, and they take this water, and it's almost like while we were looking the other way, what was just ordinary water a second ago becomes wine. And everybody is amazed at what's happened. But here's the thing I think is amazing. Not that Jesus does this, because it turns out even people who watch the basic chemistry video online, or people who own a little bit of food coloring, can turn something clear into something that looks like wine. The thing that amazes me isn't that Jesus could do a cool thing like taking clear water and make it look like it's wine. That's just a part of the trick. The thing that amazes me in this story is that Jesus, who clearly has divine power and amazing ability to do things from turning water into wine and raising the dead, the very divine Son of God, in this moment when the stakes are low, and nobody's going to die at the end of this day, nobody's life is in danger in the scene, but Jesus cares about these people and their situation just because they're in need, and Jesus has it in mind to bring more joy into the world rather than less. Just doing a cool thing is, okay, that's a stunt. But Jesus' willingness to do this without making himself the center of attention, just to make things better for a couple who otherwise would have been embarrassed or put to shame, that's something that says something about the character of who Jesus is, and that makes him compelling. So think for a minute about this scene, right? We don't know the details of what's going on with this couple, but it seems likely either they don't have the resources to have bought a huge amount of wine in advance of the wedding ceremony, or somebody did a grossly bad job of estimating how much wine all their guests would drink, or they didn't know how many people would come. One way or another, there's not enough wine, and it's going to be a disappointment. It's going to be a reputational dark mark on their record. It's going to be something shameful if you're known as the people who threw a party and didn't have enough food for the guests. These are people, this young couple just starting out, are going to be embarrassed if word gets out that their party wasn't good. The family's going to be held in negative esteem because they invite everybody to the party and then there's not enough food or drink or something like that. Jesus cares about that. Now, here's the other thing that amazes me about this story. Is that at first, Jesus has a good list of reasons why, no, I really shouldn't help right now, I shouldn't intervene. He doesn't say them all out loud to his mom, but we can imagine some of the things going on in Jesus' mind. Number one, Jesus says, my hour hasn't come yet. Jesus is kind of aware. Once he sort of goes public, once it becomes known that he has this divine power to do amazing things, like eating crowds of loaves and fishes, or water into wine, and curing the sick, that sort of sets into motion a whole timetable. At some point, once everybody is starting to flock to this Jesus, he's going to that much more quickly raise the attention of the respectable religious people. He's going to become public enemy number one that much more quickly. Jesus knows, eventually, at the end of his mission is a cross. And to set that in motion earlier means he's headed to a cross that much more quickly. Jesus could have been saying to his mom, look, mom, you don't understand. If I do this now, it's going to shorten the time we've got together. That's going to shorten my life. That's going to, the whole divine plan hangs on me and my ministry. And you're wanting to make it, set things up by months or even years because they've run out of wine. But we're talking about the salvation of the world here. These are big cosmic divine plans. People have been waiting centuries for the coming of the Messiah. You want to step up the timetable? Have said any or all of those things, and they would have been true. There's reasons why Jesus could have said, I haven't chosen to make this be my big public entrance. That sort of sets things into motion that maybe the world isn't ready for, or maybe I wasn't prepared for. Maybe, too, Jesus is thinking, there's a big danger if I get known as just the guy who does party tricks, right? After all, anybody with food colored and water into something that looks like wine. And Jesus hasn't come to just be a trickster or a huckster or a snake oil salesman. Jesus also hasn't come to be anybody's personal genie. And Jesus knows, if it gets known out there widely that he's the kind of guy who can turn water into wine, people will be chasing after him for all sorts of not savory reasons. Maybe just wanting to use him for whatever tricks or things or whatever entertainment they have in mind. Jesus realizes when it becomes known he's got this ability that can be abused, or people may want to make him into a celebrity rather than the Savior. For whatever list of reasons Jesus has, they're all good ones, they're all solid ones. And what amazes me in this story is that even though Jesus is well aware this is going to move up the timetable, this is going to change the big divine plan to some degree, this might even bring the cross happening that much more quickly, and that there is the risk other people will abuse the celebrity status of Jesus, the worker of wonders, he does it anyway. Jesus has a plan with a capital P. He has principles, abstract reasons why this isn't the time, and yet when it comes face to face with, here are people who are in need. Here are people who would have been put to shame, had their special day, their big celebration rained on, and Jesus chooses to bring joy to it anyway, even though this is not a life or death situation. There's plenty of other times, right, where Jesus is there, and is there to help somebody who is there at death's door, or somebody dealing with a life-threatening illness. Those are times that we'd all say, sure, that makes sense for Jesus to try out divine power and work a wonder. Here, this is simply a matter of they've run out of refreshments at the wedding reception, and yet Jesus does it anyway. It amazes me that in this story we come face to face with a God who doesn't just care about quote-unquote spiritual things, but who cares about the ordinary, everyday life of people in physical bodies who eat and drink and go to parties and celebrate and get married and have lives. It amazes me that Jesus doesn't say to his mom, "Don't you know I've only come for spiritual things? I've only come to save people's souls or get people into heaven or die on the cross." Jesus doesn't say that back to his mom, but instead, "You're right, Mom. Whatever the need is, okay. Because they have the need. Because I care about these people in the ordinariness of their situation. Yeah, I will do good to bring life to them, to help their party be a celebration." Jesus doesn't say, "I'm only here for spiritual stuff." He cares about what it is to be human in these bodies, with the particulars of being embodied people, food and drink and shelter and love and friendship. That's amazing to me. The other thing that is amazing to me is, if we dare to believe that Jesus shows us what God is like, and I think that's a fair thing for us to say, it means that God doesn't just care about the things we imagine are spiritual, but that God cares about us in all the particularity of human life. God isn't just here to wow us with the amazing stuff God can do, but those things are ways of getting our attention so we know that this God cares about you and me in the ordinary physical stuff of our lives. The joys and the sorrows, the struggles coming up at work, the wrestling you're doing in your family life, all those things are things God cares about. Sometimes we have a way, especially we church folk, we respectable religious people, of imagining you can divide the world up into their spiritual stuff that matters to God and their secular stuff that we don't touch or God isn't interested in or we don't care about. And here's God saying, "Turns out I care about the parties too." Here's God saying, "I care that this couple not be put to shame because everybody finds out they ran out of wine at their wedding." Here's God saying, "I care that people have a joyful time at this celebration." Here's God as life of the party, not shaming them or looking down at them for doing something reckless, like having a party. Whatever else this story tells us about Jesus, it says that Jesus is somebody who loves being human and being with other humans. That Jesus loves us in all the particularity of us. And that means, too, there's nothing that we can't bring to God as well. And sometimes we sort of put ourselves in the situation of, there's some stuff that matters to God, and those are things I can pray about. And then there's other stuff I shouldn't bother God with. The troubles I'm having at work, or the argument I had with a friend, or the stress I'm having with my kids or my grandkids. No, that's stuff I'm on my own with. God's there for just, you know, spiritual stuff. But maybe everything has to do with God. Maybe everything is spiritual. Maybe everything is infused with the presence of God. And maybe God cares all the way down to our eating and drinking, our partying, our celebrating, our joys and our sorrows, and everything in between. What would it look like this week to live as though everything we step into is something that matters to God and is open to God's presence? What if every situation we face, instead of immediately going, "No, this is probably one I can't pray about, God won't care about this," or "This one isn't important enough for God to matter, so this one I've got to solve on my own." What if every part of our lives we see as God, this matters to God, and God cares about this because God cares about me, all the way to the details of everyday, ordinary stuff. It means that there's no part of our lives that's off limits to God, and no part of our lives that God is indifferent or apathetic towards. And even maybe it tells us God loves us more than God loves capital P plans or abstract capital P principles. We can sometimes do that too. We can sometimes, in our own life, here's how life is supposed to go. Here's the things I'm supposed to accomplish. And we sort of live as though, as long as things are going to the plan, that's fine. But the moment things get shaky, the moment there's a curveball thrown, or a bump in the road, or a twist in our plans, we get all freaked out. Jesus shows us the beautiful way of saying, "You know what? People matter more than the plan following the way I expected it to. People matter more than abstract principles. People matter even than whatever other cosmic designs were happening when Jesus says, 'Okay, I'll turn water into wine for this couple.' Even knowing that might complicate the divine plan to save and redeem, even if that steps up the timeline of the cross, even if that adds additional risk or challenge for Jesus, who will later be treated like he's just a celebrity rather than the Savior. Jesus bears all those risks because he loves people more than the plan. People more than the abstract principle. In other words, Jesus loves you more than everything following a script." That can be a surprising reassurance for us church folk, especially church folk in a tradition like ours whose way of doing church is so often we follow the script. The book says what I'm supposed to do, where I'm supposed to go, where I'm supposed to stand. If that's our picture of how God is, my goodness, we're going to end up thinking, what happens when I get into a situation I never anticipated? What happens if I make a choice that wasn't according to the plan? Does God still care about me? Yep. Whatever you face this week, Whatever times we've had to throw out plan A or B or C or D, and my suspicion is in the last 2 years of a pandemic, we've been throwing out plans at night. That seems to be all we do these days, is take whatever our plan was and throw it out and make up a new one on the fly. We are not abandoned by God in times when things don't go according to plan. God loves you more than plan. God loves you more than abstract principles. The thing that wows me about what Jesus does at the wedding isn't just that he can turn water into wine. Wow, isn't that cool? Lots of people can do cool stuff that I can't do. But the God who has this ability, the Jesus who can do that for real, not as a trick with food coloring and water, the Jesus who does that for real is willing to do it even when it's just the ordinary needs of a couple celebrating at their wedding reception. Because these people and their ordinary situations matter. It reminds me, whatever I'm facing this week, even if in the big scheme of things, the struggles I'm wrestling with feel like small potatoes compared to struggles somebody else may go through, they matter to God. And I can face this week knowing there's nothing that God goes, sorry, that's not important enough for me to bother with. There's nothing that God says, that didn't make it into my inbox of things that count. Whatever's on my heart is on God's. What an amazing thing to say about God. Whatever is on your heart is on God's heart too. Step into this week, knowing even the ordinary struggles and troubles and mess ups and failures and deviations from the plan we go through, these are things that can be lifted up to God. And you know, God does amazing things, even in those ordinary places. That, dear ones, is what makes Jesus worth putting our trust in. Beyond any wowing spectacle that can happen, Jesus present through all the ordinary stuff along the way. Amen. The congregation rises as you're able, and we'll sing our hymn of the day on the insert in this feast of love, and Yvonne will play all the way through one time through the melody to introduce it.
Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father,
death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come.
With the whole people of God in Christ Jesus, let us pray for the church, those in need, and all of God's creation. By your Spirit, activate within your church gifts of faith, healing, and prophecy. Unite those who profess your name across congregations, denominations, and geographic boundaries. Open our hearts to recognize and celebrate surprising miracles. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
Your creation reflects your generosity. Bless farmers, migrant farm workers, orchard keepers, ranchers, and all those who tend to land. Protect food and water sources from destruction so that all can eat and drink and be satisfied. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
By your Spirit, grant wisdom, knowledge, and discernment to those who hold leadership positions at any level. Move policymakers towards compassionate decisions that build safe and just communities. Lead all authorities in seeking and serving the common good. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
As Jesus provided generously in a moment of need, provide generous gifts of healing for those in need this day, especially Sam Elkin, Dennis, Carla, Alice, Lori, Ron, Tom and Marge Bash, all those affected in the Texas synagogue shooting, and all those whose names we do not know. Provide abundantly for all who are hungry or thirsty, all seeking shelter, and all who seek peace. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
You see us for who we are, and you delight in us. Embrace those struggling with self-worth, self-identity, or significant life transition. Remind us that nothing can separate us from your love. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
Since we have such great hope in your promises, O God, we lift these and all our prayers to you in confidence and faith through Jesus Christ our Savior.
Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you all.
And also with you.
You're invited to share a sign of Christ's peace with one another. back cover of your hymnal.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your heart.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
Thank you.
might be for the world signs of your gracious presence in Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. We sing as our sending hymn number 487, What Feast of Love, 487.